Hello everyone! Today, based on popular demand, we will learn about BlobAssets. We will see what they are, why they are useful, how to use them, and what caveats you should pay attention to. Let's start with the what. The documentation has a rather technical explanation of them. In short, that means that BlobAssets are read-only data structures that can be stored and copied efficiently. They are set once on creation and cannot change. As read-only data structure, they are thread-safe, so they can be referenced on component and used in jobs with no race condition issues. Great, but why do I want that? Well, it's all about memory management. ECS components are structures. It means that each entity that has a component has a copy of the value, even if those values are identical. Let's take our tower data for instance. If I create a tower, the tower component will take up 32 bytes of memory. If I create 10 identical towers, it will take 320 bytes. A BlobAsset on the other hand is referenced on each entity, allowing you to save memory the more entity you have. For a single tower, we would have the 8 bytes of the BlobAsset reference and the 32 bytes of data, so 40 bytes. But for 10 towers, we would have 10 times the BlobAsset reference, so 80 bytes, plus the 32 bytes of the data, so in total 122 bytes. With that, you can avoid your game turning into a Google Chrome RAM angry monster. Now, how to implement it? We will replace our tower data component by a tower config asset that will have a BlobAsset reference of tower config. The tower config will hold all the static information about our tower data. In the backer, we can build our blob asset and reference it on the entity using our component. We declare a blob builder, construct the root, assign the blob data, and finally create the reference. You will notice that we use some allocators. An allocator allows us to define what kind of memory we want to use. The temp allocator will live only for the time of the context. The temp job and persistent allocator will live until they are disposed of. But the temp job allocator is meant to be used in a job context and as such should not live more than 4 frames. If it exceeds that lifetime, a warning will be thrown in the console. We will have the opportunity to review that again once we dive into jobs. Back to our BlobAsset. Now that we have it, we can rely on the BlobAsset store to avoid duplication of BlobAssets. It will also keep track of how many assets references that BlobAsset to dispose of it once none are left. This is all hidden behind the magic method addBlobAsset. The last thing to do in the backer is to add the BlobAsset reference to a component of our entity. Now, we can use it in our system. To use it, we need to get the component that holds the reference and then get the blob data. Take note that you should retrieve the data using the ref keyword. Finally, we use the data in our code. If you head back to Unity now and try it, you will see that it no longer works. Or if it does, it's pure luck. That's because of the caveat number 1. I knowingly let a mistake get into my backer code. If you watch my previous video on backers, you may be able to spot it. If you did not watch it, you should go check it out after this video. The issue we have here is that the backer is working in a different world than the runtime world. So the entity reference we get from the get entity call will not return the runtime entity reference. When we create the projectile from the prefab, the system fails because it's not the correct prefab. Then why does it work when we use an entity reference in a component instead of the blob? Because components and buffers support a functionality called entity remapping. This functionality will detect that a component or buffer has a reference to an entity, keep track of them, and update it with the proper entity reference after baking. This is not supported by BlobAssets. After all, they are read-only, so once set, they should not be updated. So don't store entities in BlobAssets. The only exception is if the entity is a prefab and the BlobAsset is created at runtime. Then you might get away with it, but at your own risks. Now, before we see how to make a blob that contains arrays, I have a few more caveats to share with you. And I must ask you to hit the like button if you enjoy my content. It helps a lot sharing this knowledge. Thank you. Caveat number 2 is concerning the scope of the BlobAsset store. You know, the magical thing that avoids duplication and keeps track of the blob to dispose of them. Well, it works on the subscene scope. So if you have several identical BlobAssets in different subscenes, they will still be duplicated. Caveat number 3 is about the way we bake our BlobAsset. By using a baker, we will create the BlobAsset for each entity that has the autolink component. It will then be deduplicated by the BlobAsset store using the hash of the BlobAsset, but we will still have paid the cost of making the BlobAsset. So if you have a lot of assets, this may hurt your development iteration time as it will take more time to bake the scene. And the final caveat before we see how to make blob arrays is related to the read-only nature of blobs. The fact is that nothing prevents you from writing to a blob asset. So if I were to say change the timer in the runtime system, it would affect all the entities that reference that asset. So be careful. They are not designed to be used like that, so maybe Unity will put some checks in the future to prevent it. That's all for the caveats. If you want me to cover a workaround for some of them, let me know in the comment section below. Now for the blob array, I will replace my dynamic buffer pass by a blob asset reference. This will avoid me copying each path point to each enemy and save me quite a bit of memory. The logic is the same. I will create a component to hold the BlobAsset reference and populate it in the baker. But to populate a blob array, we must first allocate the necessary memory using the allocate method of the blob builder. Then we can populate each waypoint to its correct value. And finally, add it to the entity. Now all that remains is to update our path follower aspect to use the blob asset and the spawner system to spawn our enemy with the correct components. There you go. Now you can go crazy with the spawn rates and number of towers without worrying about exceeding your memory budget. If you enjoyed the video, hit the like button, and if you want me to cover something specific, like workaround for some of the caveats, let me know in the comments below. See you next time!